Moving along, we don't have any old business. Under new business, we have SPR 2023-020, Motown Sports Group, and they are, their project there is to construct an entertainment campus consisting of an area, an arena, youth sports facility, family fun center, including restaurant, arcade, laser tag, bowling, IMAX theater, expo center, fitness center, daycare, spa, rehabilitation center, dance, aerobic studio, adult daycare, retail, food court, as well as a surf swim park, football, soccer facility, golf center, coaching facility, tech center, and pet hotel. And also future land use is to include three hotels and retail. And is the commissioner here?
Good evening. My name is Glen, DeSimone. I'm president of Prime Design Systems. I'm the architect for the project. That's the overall site. Again, we're bounded by Vining on the east, Wick on the south, Wayne on the west, and Ecorse on the north. Again, for those who don't remember the history of this project and this site, we've been working since 2017 on trying to develop this project on this site. It is based around a youth sports complex that then has other amenities that expand that function. This site is approximately 400 acres, and over the time we've been doing our due diligence, surveying the site, determining the woodlands, the wetlands, the waterways, floodplains, and determining what is buildable on this property. You'll see in the northwest corner, that area has been discovered to be mostly wetlands that are, in many cases, regulated by EGLE, and therefore our development in that area was restricted. There's a set aside easement for a nature conservancy that was part of the subdivision development north of us, which we can't touch. And unfortunately, in our previous designs, that was a major area where we had specifically our arena and our tech center. So we've worked around the wetlands. So we're at one point we were disturbing over 20 acres of wetlands. EGLE, in our discussions with EGLE, they quickly let us know that that would not be accepted and asked us to try to get that number below 10 acres. So we've worked hard to get to that. Right now you're looking at something that's just under 8 acres of disturbed wetlands. Therefore, we were forced to consolidate the project. As you see, it's a much tighter design than any of our previous proposals and require most of the parking now has to be in a structure. There's very little site surface parking. Everything is, or most of it is in two structures. One large structure that services the youth sports, the football, soccer field, and the water park, surf park, and then another dedicated parking garage that services the arena and that function, future function in the open block to the top. Again, our challenges as we explored this were, again, the easements. We also have an overhead high tension power line that runs across the site east to west at the roughly the northern third line. You can sort of see my little corner will work on this. That's why it has these enlargements. But the there's a line across the, it runs east and west right there. That's it. So that restricts us to some degree of certainly not being able to build that And we've come down to a very small portion of our property being developable. So we're looking at phase one here, and we're looking for a preliminary concept site plan approval at this point, just to make sure that we're on the same page with you and your understanding where we're headed before we go through all the engineering and landscaping and stormwater development and those type of things. And so you can see we have a major roadway that runs north of Smith, curves around, hits a roundabout, and then ultimately exits out at Lane Road. That's Henry Ruff Road. That's in the Henry Ruff Road. Roughly in the Henry Ruff Road, there's a easement, a right-of-way there. We're close to that, as close as we could be, because some of that right-of-way is affecting wetland. We developed a new roadway, what we're calling Bardwell Drive, that comes off of E-Course and feeds our property from E-Course Road south to the roundabout, and then allows traffic to flow to either directly into the arena property or circle around to the other properties. It ultimately exits south towards Wick Road. We extend Smith Road in the middle there, and a second and a smaller roadway. It's not a divided boulevard. It's just a one lane each way road that services the southern portion of our property and just helps distribute the traffic to the roundabout and the main road. Our development includes, again, the arena is designed to have 9,000 permanent seats with a maximum seating of 14,000 for certain events. It has 28 VIP suites, a club, restaurant, two additional restaurants, and its primary functions are for basketball, hockey, concerts, things like the circus, and any kind of exposition or trade show type thing. The U Sports function, which is the building in the middle, has a basketball component that has 12 courts and viewing meeting rooms that service that function. It has a hockey facility with four rinks, which are convertible to indoor soccer. They also have a viewing meeting area. Each of those hockey rinks have 1,000 seat capacity and a concession area. As I say, they can be converted to indoor soccer. We have an IMAX theater that'll have two 400 seat screens. We have an esports arena that has four arenas, each with 300 seat capacity. A family fun center that includes a restaurant and a bar, an arcade area, and other activities like rock wall climbing, laser tag, and bowling. The rest of the building, we have retail areas spaced around the complex, a day spa, a daycare, adult daycare, a rehabilitation and therapy center, dance and aerobic studio, a fitness center, running track, an expo center, and in our promenade, which is an open air area, there would be a food court and other seasonal type activities. In the smaller complex to the east of that, we have a youth football and soccer field. Each of those has 1,500 seats, lockers, concessions, and a press box in each of those fields. The larger oval-shaped building off of Vining is our water park surf park. Inside of that is a wave pool, a sandy beach, Olympic-sized competition pool that would have approximately 500 seat capacity, a diving pool. Both of those would be for competitions that are either at high school or college level that they could use those facilities. There's a lazy river, water slides, snack bars, two restaurants, and other activities like zip lines and walking paths. Down in the lower left, you'll see a golf center, not unlike a Top Golf or Atomic Golf. It has 96 tee suites, a bar, a restaurant, and two outdoor activity areas. At the top of Quick Road, you'll see a tech center that is basically to act as a business incubator for new firms to come in and rent and use space and share common functions such as conference rooms and secretarial pools and things of that nature. We have a pet hotel that is to the east of the tech center. And again, the main concept of this project is to attract youth teams to come in for either tournaments or training. And it is the nature of those type of events where the families come along with the athlete. And so we want the entire family, everybody from the dog to the infant, to grandma, grandpa, if they need adult daycare, whatever we need to accommodate, so that during their 3 to 4 day stay for these events, they have just about all of the functions at their fingertips that they can attend and enjoy. The down at the small lake, we are providing our own power facility because of the amount of power that we need for the project. We're also looking at providing cogeneration of our own power using the lake as a geothermal heat sink to be able to help us from an energy standpoint. We're also looking at ways to put solar panels, if allowed by the airport authority, on the probably on the top of the parking garages. And then, like I say, generate most of our own power and be able to sell back any excess that we generate. The parking garages, the one for the youth sports water park, has 2,700 spaces in it. It's 3 stories tall. The arena has 3,300 spaces in it. It's 4 stories tall. And that would be our phase one, as you see, what we're presenting tonight. Phase two ultimately would be hotels. There are 3 spots currently designated as future hotels. One is south of the arena, one is south of the water park, and one is east of the pet hotel off of Wick Road. Phase three would be a mixed use function in the southeast corner. That would be a combination of community services, retail, residential type, and professional offices, things of that nature. Once again, phase three is a ways down the road, but those are the type of functions that we're considering. And a marina that services the large lake, because we do want to make that a recreational lake in the future. Our goal tonight, as I say, is to conceptually approve what I'm showing you today for our phase one site plan, to approve the density that you see that we're proposing here as far as the size and proximity of all the different functions. We'd like to make sure that all the proposed uses that we're asking for are compliant in your minds with the existing zoning, which is RC, and then to approve the proposed parking ratios and the concept of overlapping the shared use of those parking spaces. At no time will all of these functions be operational at capacity at the same time, and so there's a balancing act which we presented about a year ago, I believe, where it showed how all the occupancy flows through the facility to where if we can provide somewhere in the neighborhood of about 6,000 spaces, we can accommodate all the uses in a comfortable ratio of parking to user. And so that's where we are tonight. Ken Bardwell, the chairman of our group, as you have already seen some of his presentation, he has his own presentation, and then we'll both be available to answer any questions, unless you have questions for me right now. Ken?
Excuse me.
Oh, go ahead.
That would be me.
Yes, ma'am.
I do have a couple of questions. One, I didn't hear anything about a tennis court or a pickleball court. Those are pretty popular, but I'm
That's
a tennis
correct.
Player, so a little bias there.
Well, again, the answer to that is the tennis could certainly work just like volleyball and some of those other secondary activities. I don't mean any disrespect to those activities, but they can be accommodated on the basketball courts when they're not being used as basketball courts. And so there is that flexibility to accommodate those functions in our basketball facility.
So two other points. One, just a little bit concerned that it may compete directly with our RAC center, our Romulus Athletic Center that we have. Some of the functions and features you mentioned that already exist over on that side of the...
I understand. Center. And again, this is our concept has always been that this is a regional facility as opposed to a community facility. Mm-hmm. This is something our demographic is, if you were to draw a radius of about 300 to 600 miles from Romulus to draw people from that demographic into this site and take advantage of our functions as well as whatever else Romulus has available to offer in other hotels. We can't accommodate all those people with only three hotels. And so all of that activity, our basketball component has a program right now that draws 400 teams in for tournaments and training throughout the year. And so, again, those people aren't using your rec center. They're coming in to use this facility to do their training and play their tournaments. Your local community residents will still be better accommodated at your facility. And if there was any need to coordinate a function that we have that you didn't have, then we would be more than willing to work with the city to accommodate that through some shared program, some membership sharing, or whatever is necessary at this point. But we have no intention of directly competing with Romulus citizens for your rec center membership as you have right now.
And last point, that road, Henry Ruff,
yes.
Backs up to a subdivision called Preserve of Romulus. Is there some kind of noise barrier that community
yes,
over there?
Wetlands.
Again, it's a little sensitive.
Again, acres of wetlands is really the answer, mm-hmm. number one. And because they're wetlands, we're very restricted as to what we can do with it under Eagle's rules and restrictions. We will have the required zoning berm along the Henry Ruff Boulevard on both sides of the road. That includes the berm in, I believe it's 3 feet high, and then it's a series of different types of growth, trees and shrubbery, that has there's a set requirement within every 100-foot length. It's our intention to provide that. And if I don't switch to that, but the second sheet, the landscape sheet, shows mm-hmm. a sample of our berm landscaping that we will apply across that entire Henry Ruff Road and also the Bardwell Road Boulevard to help with that acoustical and lighting, just the traffic lighting driving through.
So question then, follow up. Carol, would that be sufficient? Because when we approved Amazon Preserves was pretty upset, and they're a distance from it with the traffic, but lighting, and they said it added noise. This does abut right to the back of some of those homes that have been there for, 15 years, and they've had nothing. And they're a little bit sensitive over there. So just a little bit concerned that you don't get kickback at some point.
Can you just slide the picture up a little bit to show what she's talking about? There we go.
Mm-hmm.
As you see, it's only that southeast corner of their subdivision is where we're even close.
Oh, I know, and I know quite a few of the residents over there. We've dealt with them on previous projects.
No, I understand that. I'm not discounting what you're saying. I'm just saying we plan on putting the berm that is spelled out in great detail in your overlay zoning for this zone. And the, like I say, the wetlands itself would prevent, and then also the overhead wires prevent any kind of serious acoustical barrier.
Just wanted to make sure that's on your radar.
I appreciate that.
So, because they'll show up.
I understand.
Just let you
know. No, I understand completely.
And I think it's important, as the commissioner indicated, is that as you hear comments tonight about this proposed cool project, great project, is that the devil's in the details. And so when you get to the back to the Planning Commission with a much more fleshed in project, those are going to be some of the things that we're going to want to highlight. So, you know, put that in the back of your head.
We want this screened
and we want it screened very well, maybe even above and beyond our ordinance requirements. So those are the kind of things that you're going to hear tonight.
Madam Chair.
Okay, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So in regards to the wetlands you're discussing, so to say, at what point are you at with Eagle in that approval of this concept of the plan?
We are at the very beginning process. We're about to file for what is called the WIP, which is, where they come out and they confirm our assessment. We've had ASTI, who's an environmental consultant, come out and demark all the wetlands. Once we get into the growing season, the Eagle will then come out and certify those wetlands, and this WIP is what it's called, which is their assessment. Once they give us that, and we all agree as to the scope of what we're asking for, then we would go through their process at this point. But we had a preliminary meeting with them, then we had a Zoom-like meeting with them, and then ASTI is dealing with them directly on a as-needed basis to get us through this winter season. It doesn't seem like winter out there except for today. But the reality is they won't even look at our site until the growing season starts in April.
Okay. And the other question I have for you is, have you consulted with DTE and as to whether they can offer the power you're going to need for this kind of complex?
The answer is yes. We have, in a conceptual way, talked with them. They've had no hesitation about it. The concept is we're hoping to be able to generate most, if not all, of the power we need on our own site with our own equipment, and hopefully even have access to sell back to DTE. So as far as even without that, they have enough service to supply us, but the reality is we're hoping to generate our own power to supply our facility. Using governmental, there are programs out there that help the capital outlay for that type of development, and then subsequently the revenue stream for selling back that excess power capacity.
And you have reached out to those entities that would supply that?
Yes, we have a consultant who is specifically geared into that program, and our series of programs with both DTE and the governments, all the different government levels at this point. And they need to see more too. We are at preliminary conceptual level. We don't have the numbers as far as this is how many, megawatts we're gonna need out here. But ultimately that'll all be calculated out and worked out with them. But we have a dedicated consultant on site to think through where you can. That's their job.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Frederick.
Just a quick question, and continuing with that discussion, how would you generate the power?
Geothermal, using the lake the lake water level. Basically, it's a sort of heat pump using the temperature of the water at depth is always somewhere around the 57 degree mark. So when it's cold out, you use 57 degree preheat water to, you know, basically generate steam or run a generator that then generates the power accordingly. In theory, in the same minute, again, it's the vice versa. If you need, it's basically what you're doing is you're taking your heat load and using it in a chilled water format that you're running. You're not running power to rooftop units. You're running a water loop through the complex that then services the facilities. And so when it's 80 degrees out, 57 degrees is nice and cool. When it's 20 degrees out, 57 degrees is nice and warm. And you basically start with that and then supplement it as you need to. And then the solar panels would supplement any additional electrical needs.
All right, thank you.
Mr. Bobada, go ahead.
Through the chair. Jessica, did you have a chance to review the synchro files for the traffic?
This is, there have been previous traffic impact studies that have been submitted. However, this is a completely new layout with completely new phasing. I have not seen any traffic impact study that is associated directly with this product.
Okay.
Yeah. We have Kimberly Horn as our traffic consultant.
Yeah, I know.
As mentioned, he's produced a rather detailed traffic study that went through OHM and reviewed in our previous concept. This one, although it is different in configuration, as far as uses are the same, we have reduced our curb cuts, which was one of their, which OHM's strong recommendations. We eliminated, we had a third one off of Vining that serviced the complex, and we had a second one off of Wayne that we've eliminated in addressing some of OHM's comments from September with our previous submission in the Kimley Horn report. The work proposed in what would be phase three in the southeast corner is up for grabs at this point because we don't have a serious clue of how it's going to be configured down there. But once we do, we'll have to take, OHM had a long list of items they wanted us to address down there also, as far as aligning roadways and working with Michigan lefts and those type of things. And we will take all of those into consideration when we know what we're doing down there.
Okay.
In phase three.
Yeah, I did get the synchro files that Carol and Kayla sent over, and I did review them. It was over 1,000 pages. Like you can see, I hate traffic. You know,
no, I understand.
I'm a huge stickler, so I went through it. My part of my background is in traffic engineering, so I went through it in detail, and I'm just curious what the animation says. It looks good on paper, you know. I'm just curious how the, you know, animation plays out, and also sorry, just a second. I'm sorry, and also I'm a little slightly concerned on the calculation used based on 0.44 increase based on what SEMCOG has stipulated for 2030. Again, with any development, we expect traffic. You expect people to come, and so I think a more realistic, shall I say, variable needs to be, you know, added to it. But overall, I'd just like to see a summary that says, okay, this is the current, and based on the development, whatever it may look like, it would increase, you know, the place I'm most concerned about is Van Born.
Which one?
Van Born. Sorry, E-Course,
oh,
my bad,
yeah,
sorry.
Yeah.
E-Course right before the preserves, there's also a school there.
Yeah.
and intersection is being put there. That's the place I'm most concerned about. But other than that, I think,
Are you thinking of the school that's on Wayne Road, just north of Smith? That's the only school I know of.
E-course.
On E-course, okay.
Metro Academy.
Metro Academy is east of...
Okay, fair enough. Again, I think we'll be the first to admit that E-course Road will need to be seriously considered for an upgrade between our uses, Amazon's uses, and anything else that goes on that roadway in the future. Because our traffic study shows almost all of our users coming from Oakland County and northern Wayne County are going to come down 275 and get off at E-course.
Correct.
And then head our way, and we will be directing them to the Bardwell Drive as opposed to going down Wayne Road and then a left turn into our... We would rather them go right into our Bardwell Drive and get them off of E-course as fast as possible. But that's a conversation that Kimley Horn and the Motown group is going to have with the MDOT people and Wayne County, more importantly,
yes,
to see exactly what needs to be done and what can be done and how we can help contributing to that resolution.
Okay. Now, my last question is, you've talked about, or you've highlighted the different phases. I didn't hear in any of the phases the condominiums that...
Yes, because of the wetland problem, we virtually have eliminated that aspect of the project.
Okay.
They were scheduled to be put in what would be the northwest corner there on the west side of Bardwell Drive, that long strip that goes east and west there, underneath the just a little north of the tension lines. That's where most of them were scheduled to be placed. And because of the wetlands and other restrictions, there's another restriction on that property from Eagle that will all but eliminate that from any future development.
So rooftops is very important for us here in Romulus. Is there anywhere else you can put it? If you're eliminating it from that area due to wetlands and other consideration, is there anywhere else you think it can?
Our phase three does have the potential of putting some mid-rise apartment-like or condominium-type residential pieces on the southeast corner, but that's again phase three, which I wouldn't even pretend to know exactly what that configuration would be at this time.
So is it by the golf course or by the hotel? Can you scroll
southeast
up?
Southeast of the big lake. It's on Wick and Vining, where it says future multi, right there.
So you eliminate the potential commercial shops there.
Oh, no, there would be a combination of all of that. The intention would be a village of all of those functions. Yes, again.
I'll address that when you're done.
But that's a future phase that we have. Again, we will try to accommodate as many of those functions as we can based on what the development market lends itself to. If Bob, you want to say something?
I understand what you're saying with respect to markets, but also the citizens of Romulus have needs.
Pardon?
The citizens of Romulus has needs.
I understand.
Okay, so I think that needs to be put at a higher priority than the market. But, you know, it's your property, it's our decision, you know, and it's important for us to meet somewhere.
I understand, and we would certainly consider that, realizing that this property is zoned regional commercial, not residential.
Correct. Okay. But at least there.
Again, in your master plan, there's no call for residential on this parcel, except in that upper northwest corner, which right now we know of no physical way to do that per Eagle's directive. But I hear you. I understand what you're saying. And there may be other opportunities. The concern I would have, beyond the zoning discrepancies, would be what type of residential are you going to put in the middle of this dense development that would be marketable?
Yeah.
And that would be my concern. There might be better places for this, and we would have to consider that than this development.
All I'm saying is you put it in before, and you took it out due to considerations, and all I'm asking is if it can be placed somewhere else.
Right.
That's all I'm asking.
I appreciate that, and duly noted.
Okay.
Bob, did you want to?
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Celeste has one question.
Yeah. Through the chair, one of the main concerns that the citizens and the governmental people here in Romulus has is Ecorse Road, when you brought up Ecorse Road. And the problem with that is we're always fighting Wayne County to try to get that road upgraded, not just in that area, but all the way through the Romulus area. And my question to you is, whenever they come through and they start upgrading the roads and so on and so forth, they're always looking for extra money and proper, you know, as far as sharing the cost of that. And to what extent are you going to commit to helping with the cost of upgrading Ecorse Road in order to take care of the traffic that is going to come into the complex that you have?
No, I understand your question. And it's a fair question. I don't have an answer for you, but the reality is we would have to consider that in whatever negotiations we have with Wayne County or even MDOT, because we have, ultimately, we're connecting to 275, and we have other MDOT issues that we want to address here as far as exits at Vining and Wayne Road. And so as a, and this is, I'm speculating, not promising, is there's an overall negotiation that needs to occur between all the entities involved, including the city, Wayne County, MDOT, and of course Motown, to come to the solution that solves the problem as best as possible.
Well,
monetarily as well as physically, you know, in concrete.
I think that is a very major concern.
I understand.
And I think that it should be involved with your concepts and your thought process.
I assure you it
all
is
the time.
Already, and I couldn't.
Because
I just
if you can't get the traffic in, you're not going to, get the traffic out.
As I, again, a large amount of our demographic, especially for the arena events, is Northern Wayne County and Oakland County. And as I say, anybody coming from those areas will certainly use 275 and most likely get off at Ecorse Road to get to us. We have to address that completely and come to a conclusion that everybody is happy with physically and financially.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Who is your next speaker?
Bob Mihelich from JLL. He's our real estate and owner's rep.
Right. Thank you. Robert Mihelich from Jones Lang LaSalle. I've been with the Bardwell Group for quite some time now. I'm in charge of assemblage of land, putting on the tenants, things of this nature for the development. And to your point, you're absolutely right. We wanted to have residential to service. We're looking at, you know, between 2,000 and 2,500 jobs that we're creating here. And with that, we know that, you know, we need to find places for people to live and put forth and make that happen. We were very disappointed when we found out from Eagle that we were unable to build on that property and be able to utilize it the way we wanted to. They said it'd be a two-year better process to even maybe scratch the surface of it. So I was tasked to go out and try and find a replacement piece of property, of which we're now working on putting another 50 acres under contract for a residential. So I'm going to answer your residential component here very shortly, and I'd like to share that with you when it's tightened up a little bit more. It's a little premature at the moment, but we're all over it. And that's something that we felt the same way. We needed that component. We also needed to be a component that's somewhat affordable, because you know, the jobs that we're creating are, you know, they have to have affordable place to live. So we're gonna put out some new products, some very, you know, dynamic new product that we're working on, and we're working with some of the builders and some of the other trades that you'll all know. and to be, you know, more news forthcoming. But we're heavily addressing that issue right now. And we were saddened to see that happen, that they took away our residential. But we will have stackables and other things around the property as well. That'll house some people. We're looking at, you know, both apartments and condos and things of that nature. But nowhere near to your point, you know, for the residents to live and have a new home. So that's on our docket. So I just wanted to address that.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you. Who do you have next?
Okay, I'd like to introduce Ken Bardwell. He's the chairman of the Motown Sports Group, and he has a very elaborate proposal of presentation for you. Ken?
I'd like to thank you to the chair, to the board members here tonight. We've come out to really just talk about, or really inform you guys about our development plans to move forward. Some of you guys already know who we are, what this project is about. I've been meeting with some of the faces up here, and also with the city administration and city council members. We've been able to get the support of the mayor and the council members to move forward with the project, to bring this project here to the city of Romulus. One of the biggest attractions was to be here as a gateway to the entire state of Michigan. And we know that Metropolitan Airport, there's 35 million plus people that fly into Metro every year. So we try to really get our marketing in this project centered around that. As was mentioned earlier about the city's master plan, the citizens, the residents, we watch quite a few council meetings and so forth. We know that there's a lot of distribution and warehouses that comes to Romulus, and we wanted to be able to bring something that's going to be a world attraction, not just to state of Michigan, but to be a part of the gateway with the city of Romulus. So our project is not just a recreational facility, it's a resort. It's an entertainment resort that's going to generate a lot of traffic that will be coming, as Glen mentioned, 600 mile radius. But we also plan to create 2,700 jobs that will be a part of our development. One of the other things that I really wanted to point out was over the past maybe 20-something years, we have been going back and forth, to try to see where and how we could do this. And one of the biggest hurdles that I was able to overcome was to bring or to assemble a world-class development team and partnerships that would make this a reality. And I've been successfully able to bring in some very big names. And I don't know if you guys are familiar with ASM Global. ASM Global is the largest sports and entertainment company in the world. They manage several venues around the world. They own the Staples Center where the Lakers play, and some other amenities or facilities around the world. We've been able to put together a partnership with them to not only manage the facility, but to partner with us and to be a part of the financing that will be a part of our financial structure to make this a reality. We also have been able to spend quite a bit of dollars up front in terms of traffic study, which I know that's one of your pet peeves there, but we've been able to hire some very good traffic study engineers. We did a feasibility study that allowed us to move forward with this project, and also talking with Ashley Capital, we've been able to get them on our side to be able to sell the property to us and then move forward. We will be submitting a joint application with them, with Eagle, very shortly to move forward. And as Glenn mentioned, our architect, the 30 acres of wetland, we had to do some configuration and changes, and we managed to be able to do that. So we knew that it was a showstopper for us. Anything that was over 10 acres with Eagle, as far as wetlands, we were able to get that down to about 7 acres now with this current design and configuration. So that was really a big plus for us and excited us to move forward. Our financing folks are looking to really get involved. We've got major sponsors, Coca-Cola and some others who have come in, given us commitments to be major sponsors. JLL is our project manager and owner's rep to our development group. Most of these folks you see here outside of the Safeway group that just left, these folks are here for Motown Sports and sitting in the audience. And we are asking for conceptual approval to move forward. And knowing that we have some other detail engineering that has to come down the road, and certainly be able to meet the criteria of the city and be able to move forward to actually develop the property. So what I wanted to do is really basically show kind of the big picture of maybe a quick video real quick of how we envision the site to look. We do know that the residents want something here other than distribution and trucks. We do know that. And I was able to see the city council meeting last Monday, and I just got some popcorn and just sat back and watched it. But the residents spoke, and what I'm here to really say is that we want to be here. We're here, we've spent a lot of money already to move forward to this point. We have a lot of the due diligence that has been completed, and that's part of the traffic study. We do have some amendments that's been made to that according to the revision of the site plan, or I should say the revised site plan. And I'm here to answer any questions that you may have before I introduce the video to you, and hopefully this will give you an even more exciting picture and view of what we're trying to do. And one more thing, I just wanted to add that the youth travel sports is a $19 billion industry. In 2026, it will grow to $77 billion. We just plan to capture just a little bit of that and bring it here to the city of Romulus, just to be able to attract the market and to be able to bring those kind of dollars here, tax dollars, to the city of Romulus. BDO has done an economic impact study for the city, county, and state, to be able to show what the economic value or benefit will be to the city in terms of this development and the jobs that's being proposed to be created. And once again, I think we're in perfect harmony with the city's master plan, the city 10-year master plan, which was introduced to us a few years ago. So we really centered our design and development around what the residents want and what we feel that would actually make the city of Romulus a world-class destination, because Coca-Cola has agreed to work with us in terms of the marketing, not just as a sponsor, but knowing that they have relationships with Delta, United Airlines, to be able to market through some of those airlines of folks flying into Metro Airport, and that would be able to come to this type of facility. So this is not a recreation center, or we like to call it a destination / youth travel sports facility. So before going into the video, is there any questions that you may have?
Just one question through the chair. Do you intend to run shuttles from the airport? Because I assume, again, we would need a lot of people to come, and with the traveling sports, we expect people to fly into DTW. So is that something that you have in mind?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, that's something that we definitely have in mind.
Okay. Very good.
We've had study, once again, I wanted to really emphasize this. We've had study sessions with council members and meetings. One of the board members, Ms. Roscoe, met with her and some of her colleagues as far as city council members, and knowing really what our intentions are and what we've been able to accomplish even to get to this point. And we've managed to gain a lot of support. And the mayor, I don't know if you've seen that in your packet. He had a letter that he just generated March 1st to support fast-track approval process as possible, to try to do whatever he can to get the project on the road. But we do know that we have to do further engineering and so forth. So I'm going to Almir.
Thank you very much. My name is Almir Omerovic. I am a senior project manager with JLL. And to the gentleman's question about the traffic study, back in August of 2023, we did put together a traffic study. It was provided to the city. OHM did provide some comments. Those were answered, and the answers to those questions were submitted with the package. The intent is still to hear back from the Planning Commission, from OHM, and further refine the traffic study as needed. And provide any other engineering that's required, be it stormwater, be it any other engineering that needs to be provided as part of this site plan approval process. So that is definitely something that will be part of the final package.
I have a question over here.
In regards to the site plan review, and I know this is all conceptual currently that you're bringing to us, but what is your time frame for being able to bring us something formally for us to review and for our consultants to review as far as a serious site plan? I know this is a serious conceptual site plan, but we're a long ways from actually getting something in stone that we can start making recommendations and approvals and so on and so forth. And so what are we looking at?
Well, assuming we receive approval conceptually tonight, and we will then be looking forward to what I assume will be an OHM review of what we've submitted, at least conceptually, and we would start that process to incorporate any comments or adjustments that have been suggested tonight and resubmit for what would probably be a preliminary site plan approval, if all goes well, within a month or so from now, as long as we don't have to make any substantial changes to what we're presenting. But we are on that track. We're currently waiting for two things. As I alluded to before, was the certification from Eagle that they will give us once the growing season starts, so that we know that we don't have any more wetlands to avoid or address. And then we have our civil engineer, Nowak and Frouse, is finishing up their site survey work, which includes the woodlands, topography, as well as other site considerations, such as all the the intersections with the roadways and some of the adjacent concerns that the traffic study addressed. Once we have all of that, the intention is to file, because under our current agreement with Ashley Capital, we're hoping to be able to have some form of preliminary approval by the end of July of this year. And that's our goal.
That's coming up real quick.
I don't mean
that. That's a lot of work.
I've got a whole staff watching this on the cable saying, oh, I got so many too many promises. Yes, you are correct. We have a lot of work to do. There's a lot of work being done as we speak that it wasn't part of this submission. But as I say, some of it is dependent on things we just don't have control over, like when does the growing season start and when does Eagle put us into their sequence to give us our certification, which is another milestone with our the current property owner and our seller. So we have a lot of steps that we have to meet in the purchase agreement, and we all come to the conclusion on or around July 31st. So we're working towards that.
Can you elaborate on your purchase agreement?
In what regard?
In regards to where you're at with that? Is that...
We're compliant to date. Some of the early milestones that were part of that were things like the wetlands, the original demarcation on the site that was done last year, some of the preliminary ultas and other survey information was provided in January of this year. On time, or actually ahead of time, I believe that one was. This submission was due, and we submitted it a day ahead of time for our deadline with them. We had a March 15th deadline. We submitted it on Thursday. You know, and so we're tracking in compliance currently. And again, as long as everybody keeps working, we've got ways to go with, you know, our next big step is Wayne County, to get in there with some discussions about stormwater control and processing, as well as we've got an engineering consultant doing some of the utility, as you asked before, the utility requirements and how we're going to address those things. All of that's happening as we speak.
Okay, thank you.
Do you have something you want to add?
Through the chair, how many site plan approvals do we expect to have through this? He's talking conceptual tonight, preliminary somewhere else, and how many site plans do we expect out of this?
Well, my understanding is it's conceptual tonight.
Which means what?
It just means that we...
With this use, I mean, obviously with the destination complex, and, you know, I mean, I feel like everybody would love to see this proposed
in
the city around us, for sure. Conceptually, where it is, where it fits with our master plan, it fits. So, I mean, the use the development is something we would love to see. I know that the city does support that.
Sure.
So with the conceptual, it's like, hey, yes, we agree to the concept of the plan. We need a full site plan submittal. It would have to go through the regular process of a full site plan review. As with the timing of this one coming in, we didn't get a chance to do too much review on it. But the next step would be a site plan review, just like normal. You know what I mean? Coming back for a site plan approval. This is just completely in a conceptual phase. But the use is something that fits in our zoning, something that I know a lot of people would love to see here.
No, I agree. That just, because we can't get into particulars here with this concept, because a lot of things could shift, move, change under normal site plan review.
Yeah.
So we're just generally saying we understand and approve of the concept as it stands.
That would be my suggestion. And again, this is an awesome plan, and I know I'm coming in, I know you've heard about this, talked about it, but just what I know of this plan, this is pretty incredible. And like I said earlier, with the Safeway, the devil's in the details in regards to layout and design. Some of our commissioners made comments about traffic, some about buffering our residents to the north, the condition of roads. All those different things are issues that we as a planning commission in the city will have to work through with the applicant. And how do we do that? Well, the applicant tonight is looking for conceptual approval. And perhaps not even the word conceptual plan approval, but the concept of a large square, we're almost talking about a square mile, a concept of a large scale recreation sports complex at this location. And to give them the comfort level to move forward with, which of course is a much more expensive plan review process. So as I understand our city's process, we're giving them a comfort level on the concept itself, perhaps not the layout or everything, but the concept of all these different uses at this location. And then they sharpen their pencil and they come back before us with much more detailed site plans, meeting our ordinance and meeting those 30, 40 different checklist items.
Exactly.
That we would carefully have to look through. And it's not going to be a walk in the park, because we're going to be looking at all these different uses and how they impact traffic, how they impact the surrounding land uses, the design, the facade, all those different things all compacted into one area. So I guess what I would say is that great project, cool project. I don't know why I think that approving the concept would go a long way with the applicants, but the caveat would be approving a concept conditional upon formal submittal meeting all of the city's specifications and rules.
Zoning ordinances.
Right, that's right.
Right.
That's fine.
So with regard to the uses, as you're saying, most of them, I mean, this is great to think of all these uses that are permitted uses. It's wonderful.
Right.
There are a few that we're seeing tonight that could trigger special land uses. The pet hotel happens to be a special mm-hmm. land use, but as you saw the process mm-hmm. earlier, we deal with those all the time. The tech center could trigger moving that into the Vining Road overlay, which again is just an overlay on top of your regional center district. There's also another option to use, or you haven't seen it in years, but bringing the preserves up and wondering why the preserves, a residential use in the regional center district, came in under your PDA. That's your planned development area, which does talk about a little bit different processes where you've got a preliminary and a final. You know, you've got these bigger picture plans, and then you focus on phases and sub areas. So there's a lot of flexibility in your ordinance, depending on the route that they, once they get, you know, beyond and start, as John says, you know, sharpening the pencil and fine tuning, you know, how the process will work. And, you know, you may see some of your old familiar processes that you haven't seen in a while that work very well. So, but it's basically site plan.
and I agree. There's just, I want to do it right, yeah. And I want to make sure everybody gets what they want out of this.
Right.
That's all I had. Thank you.
Good. Right. Well, basically, the Planning Commission is in support of, we're in support of the concept of the proposed use for Motor City's Moto Motown Sports Group site, subject to compliance with the zoning ordinance and any other applicable city standards and requirements. And in order to do that, I would need a motion that we are in compliance, that we do agree.
Madam Chair.
That you're in agreement, excuse me?
Hit the button.
You're in agreement with the concept itself?
Yes.
And supportive of the concept itself? And like you said, conditional upon our ordinance, rules, specifications, all those different things?
Exactly, exactly.
Sure, you can make a motion to that effect, sure.
That's our motion.
You want to make the motion?
We should see the video.
Yeah, I think we should see the video. They want to play a video.
Video.
This is not a video. Sorry, cute.
What is it about?
That's what the video is.
What? He has a video, cute.
Oh, are they talking? Did you want to show your presentation?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I think that's what he's talking about, the presentation.
Something that maybe isn't going to.
To the planning consultant.
Doesn't matter what it looks like.
You're very spot right on. For us to be able to spend over $100 million and be able to move forward, not just with only ASCII capital, but to do further engineering commitments and so forth, it was very important for us to be able to get it conceptual. And we knew that we had to come back to have further detailed engineering to be able to get permits and so forth, to start building and all those good things. So thank you for the clarification and understanding, and thank you for your support before you vote. We thank you. My group here.
Thank you.
we're making revisions to that as far as the housing and so forth. As Bob Mihelich mentioned, we're looking to address the housing situation, the rooftop situation. So we're working on that, and any questions that you guys have?
Alrighty.
Now we have to restate the motion that we had already stated, or can we?
Yes, yeah, you could.
Yeah, restate it.
Yeah, no question.
Planning Commission is supportive of the concept of this proposal and the use for Motown Sports Group site, subject to the compliance of the zoning ordinance and any other applicable standards and requirements.
Support.
Support?
Yep.
Okay. So I have a motion for Mr. McAnally, supported by Mr. Bawade, to acknowledge that we're in support of the concept of the proposed use of the Motown Sports Group, site, subject to compliance with the zoning ordinance and any other applicable city standards and requirements. Any discussion?
I just have one comment. About 24 years ago, there was a project introduced to the city. It's now called Fairways at Gateway. It was the first of its kind and large. It's the community, the golf community. It's a golf course with houses that were built around it. It's great. However, there was so many things that were not foreseen, that were not planned out. And so the residents who now live in that community are paying for poor planning. So just coming from a person that with PTSD, because I live there, and knowing that that plan that was developed and those that were at the helm didn't know what they were doing because it was the first of the kind in this area, and the mayor at that time had no concept of what to expect. And so now, looking back, we have drainage issues and unfinished parts of it. So just mentioning that so that when you are in the process, if you can think as far forward as you can, so that in 25 years, the people that are here, that are living amongst it, we're not actually picking up the bill, because my community is picking up the bill for some of those things that were not foreseen, that were not planned out well, because those that were at the helm didn't really know what they were planning and doing. So, but yes and amen, bring the project. We want to see it. Just consider us 25 to 50 years from now. Put whatever you can in place. But we appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Duly noted.
I'm sorry. We have a motion on the floor right now. So we have to finish voting on the motion. And that was Mr. McAnally.
Yes.
Supported by Mr. Bawade.
Oh, I thought your roll call.
Pardon me?
Go ahead.
Oh. You want to do roll call?
Yeah. Are we going to vote?
Mm-hmm. Well, we're supporting motion, yeah. So we would have to vote on it, correct?
On motion?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. McAnally.
Yes.
Mr. Bawade.
Yes.
Mr. Krova.
Yes.
Mr. Frederick.
Yes.
Mr. Godfelty.
Yes.
Ms. Roscoe.
Yes.
Ms. Jameson.
Yes.
Mr. Long.
Yes.
The chair votes yes. We have passed the motion that we are in support of the concept.
Thank you.
I would only say, commissioners, that and the applicants sit down with administration to kind of flesh in the process on and the direction, whether that's going through a PD process, overlay district. Because as the planner for the city said, there are some special use standards, and those may require public hearings. So really, I mean, that's your next step is, like I said, sharpening your pencils with administration before it comes back to the commission.
Thank you. Let's go.